the EFF here in the Western Cape, Kumisan Trinitongu, the national organizer, the leadership of the EFF Students Command here in the University of the Western Cape, the leadership of the EFF Student Command nationally. I saw the Treasurer General is here. The leadership of the incoming SRC of the University of the Western Cape. We have been sent here by the leadership of the EFF to mark the 100th anniversary of the Great Socialist Revolution. And we came at a time when there are SRC elections here in the University of the Western Cape. So I'm going to take this opportunity as well to invite the students of the University of the Western Cape to join the students of the University of Limpopo, to join the University of the Witwatersrand University, to join the University of Ghana, to join Val University of Technology and many other student colleges where the EFF Students Command is in charge. So if you don't vote for the EFF Students Command to win, you are going to be left behind, because all other students all over the country are voting for the EFF Students Command. So I am here to invite all of you that don't be left behind by the revolutionary wave that is sweeping across South Africa in terms of change that is needed. But it's important that we mark this important event, the 100th anniversary of the greatest event in the history of mankind, the Great Socialist October Revolution, is one of the most important single events in the world of all of us who call ourselves Marxist-Leninists. So I'm here to speak about the significance of that socialist revolution. So the poster that has invited us here said that we are going to be in a lecture, and a public address will be given by ourselves on behalf of the EFF. So I thought that because it's a lecture, all of you are going to come with notebooks and take notes on what we are going to talk about. Because in the EFF, we use lectures for exactly that, that is education. Because in the EFF, we're preoccupied with one thing and one thing only, that is to learn. That is what Lenin said when he addressed on the tasks of the youth leagues and young people in general. He said, overall, the role of young people can be summed up in one word, and that is to learn. So as students, as revolutionary activists, we must know that our obligation is to learn. And one of the things that you should know about the leader of the Great Socialist October Revolution, whom we're going to speak about in great detail today, is that he spoke to students in many occasions. At the core of the socialist revolution were messages which Vladimir Ilyich Lenin spoke to many students when he was in exile, when he went back to Russia, when he led the revolution, when he was a prime minister and the leader of the revolution, when he was a president of Russia. He continued to speak to students to make them understand the significance and importance of a revolution. And why are we, as the EFF, taking a pause to speak about the Great Socialist October Revolution? It's because we are a socialist organization as the EFF. The ideology of the EFF, we say in the founding manifesto, that we are a Marxist-Leninist-Fanonian organization. Oh, yeah. We derive our inspiration from that tool of analysis. Our ideological telescope is Marxist, Leninist, Fanonian. And the Leninist in that component speaks to Vladimir Lenin, who was the leader of the great socialist revolution which we are commemorating today. And one of the most important things in the style of Lenin, which he used to take when he spoke to students, was always to assure them that you must not worry if you do not understand in the first instance of discussing Marxism. You must not worry if you do not understand everything. You will get time when you read further and engage further on all these questions to understand all the issues that relate to our revolution. And why are we doing this? Why are we going on this theoretical discussion? It's because we strongly believe what is written behind most of you's t-shirts, that there can never be a revolutionary movement without revolutionary theory. So we have to be grounded on proper revolutionary theory. So I'm going to do basically seven things, and I think we must take note of the things that we're going to do as part of this lecture. Number one, we're going to give a historical account of what exactly is this socialist revolution that happened in Russia 100 years ago. And then we're going to speak about the role ideologically and theoretically which Lenin played in that revolution. Number three, we're going to speak about the significance of the socialist revolution in world history and world politics. So those of you who are studying this in classroom, I'm sure if you're still going to write exams, you're going to pass with flying colors. Number four, we're going to speak what has been the impact of the socialist revolution to the South African politics. What have been the most influencing aspects of the socialist revolution to what we experienced and are experiencing in South Africa today? Number five, we're going to speak about the nature of capitalism in South Africa. What are the features that define capitalism in South Africa? And all of us need to understand that, because we can't say as the EFF that we are anti-capitalist internationalist movement if we do not thoroughly understand the nature and character and form of capitalism. What kind of capitalism are we confronting in South Africa? And then number six, we're going to speak about the immediate challenges. And then lastly, we're going to speak on what is to be done. Now, most of you will know that in the short history of the EFF, the first national gathering of the EFF was called a National Assembly on What is to be Done. So that component of what is to be done draws inspiration from a perspective, a writing of Vladimir Lenin, which he called What is to be Done, the Challenges Facing the Movement. So as students, you can never call yourself a revolutionary until the latter end if you have not been familiar with a perspective called what is to be done and the context of that particular perspective. So the first gathering of the EFF was called the National People's Assembly on What is to be Done. And that is the assembly that happened on the 26th of July in Soweto, and resolved that we should form the EFF as an anti-capitalist economic emancipation movement, an anti-capitalist revolutionary militant and radical economic emancipation movement, which appreciated that those that came before us fought for political freedom, and we had to take the baton and fight for economic emancipation. You will all of you understand what is economic emancipation when we go there. But before I go deeper into all those seven things that I've highlighted today, please allow me to divert briefly to deal with some of the immediate challenges so that we do not forget what is confronting society today. So in Capital Volume 3, Karl Marx dealt with the question of the public debt. The public debt, he characterized it as one of the aspects that the capitalist use to move money around and not expand the economy through investments. Now, South Africa, if you had listened to what was said a day or two ago, is confronted with one of the most deepening and complex public debts. And how does that come about? I want you to pay attention to this. It's a slight diversion. I'm going to come back to the main topic. Now, the budget of the state as a whole, of government as a whole, it's about 1 trillion. But SARS every year at the current stage collects about 1.3 to 1.4 trillion rands. It's not a lot of money. And then it takes back that money as tax returns. And then the budget remains to be 1 trillion rands. Where does the tax come from? Number one, it comes from those who are employed as personal income tax. Number two, it comes from corporate income tax, which is the companies that pay taxes. Number three, it comes from VAT, the value added tax. So all of us here are paying tax, we're taxpayers. Because VAT is one of the biggest contributors of that 1.3 trillion. Now, when you have got a trillion rand remaining as budget, with the debt that the state has now, we are using 160 billion rands, which is 16% of the budget of the state, to pay back the interest of the debt that South Africa has. So already 16% is taken from the fiscus to pay for a debt. And out of the remaining amount, about 220 billion is used for basic education only. So that is 20%. Basic education only takes 20% of the budget. 180 billion rand is used for social grants. That is 18%. So you can add 16% of the debt plus 20% plus 18% of social grants. And then about 100 billion on healthcare. And overall, government employees that are paid from the central government are paid salaries annually of more than 500 billion rands. And because there is no confidence domestically of the current political establishment, because there is no confidence globally of the current political establishment, many people who potentially were going to pay for taxes are not putting their money in South Africa. They are taking it to other parts of the world. We are correctly demanding free education, and when we take over government, as the EFF, are going to implement fee-free, quality, decolonized education. But at the pace and the rate at which the current government is moving, I can tell you today for free that there will never be free education under Jacob Zuma. There will never be fee-free education under the kleptocracy. Kleptocracy means a government of thieves. Under the kleptocracy of Jacob Zuma, there will never be free education. So the permanent solution that we must all of us think about is to permanently remove the kleptocracy of Jacob Zuma from government. Yeah. And this happens against the backdrop that majority of our people are living in poverty. The people who are living below the poverty line in South Africa has exceeded 30 million people. Unemployment is at 40%. We have got a very deep crisis. I thought that before we speak deeply about the socialist revolution, I must paint that picture for you of where we are as a country. We are a country that is in huge debt, and instead of coming with solutions, that bold boy, the blue-eyed boy of the Gupta's Manusigigaba, he was just announcing that the debt of the state is going to be paid at more than 200 billion within the next 2 to 3 years. So they have reached a ceiling, they have got no more solutions. Even if you historically voted or associated with the ANC, it will not be rational for you to continue to give them political power, because they are unable to utilize that political power to empower our people. They are unable to utilize political power to contribute to the betterment of our lives. Now, when we started here, we say, Viva Socialism. When we sing, we say, Socialism is the future. Socialism is what we are fighting for. Now, in every lecture, before you speak about something that is going to recur a lot in your theme, you should give a conceptual basis, a conceptual foundation. So I'm going to start as well by giving you what is socialism. Because during the course of this week, I got a DM in Twitter from one of the students who said that, I want to join the EFF, but I'm worried that you are fighting for socialism. Isn't socialism antiquated? Isn't it old-fashioned? Then I realized that the capitalist imperialist propaganda that got to date the concept and principle and practice of socialism has reached far ends. And we've got an obligation as socialists now to change what is understood to be socialism. Now, in the most basic definition of socialism, is that it is a transitional phase from capitalism to communism. And how does that transitional phase happen? Is that if society is governed by a capitalist system where few individuals are in control and ownership of the means of production of capital, of the huge banks, of the huge factories, of the land, where private individuals own everything and employ labor, when a working class party takes political power, you do not immediately after taking political power say that from tomorrow we are a communist society. You institute what is a transitional phase, and that phase is called socialism. Now, under socialism, an institution that is called the state continues to exist, but now it is under the control of the oppressed, the working class majority. And the state, Karl Marx says that it becomes nothing but a dictatorship of the proletariat. I'll give you a clearer context when we move in terms of what a dictatorship of the proletariat means. And under socialism, the state begins to discontinue private ownership of the means of production. You take the land and give it to the people. You take the huge mines, the factories, and give to the people. Everything is done for common good. Now, what socialism is not, socialism is not some huge bureaucracy. It's not some undemocratic institution that disrespects the wills of the people. And socialism does not mean that personal non-exploitative property is going to be owned commonly. Like when you own your clothes, when you put a jacket here, someone is going to take it. So the capitalist propaganda always spread a message that under socialism, if you park a car outside and you enter inside, when you come out, someone would have taken the car. That is not the case under socialism. And socialism does not mean that people must not come with new ideas, innovative ideas, in terms of how you expand the economy. And socialism does not mean that people must not have their own private beliefs in terms of religion, in terms of everything. Because one of the dominant capitalist bourgeois propagandas has been that socialism is against God, it's against people's religion. You can choose whichever religion you want to associate with. Socialism is about the democratic control of the key means of production of capital, saying that let us centralize the ownership of the economy so that all of us can benefit out of it, not few individuals. And what does that do? It then allows space for access to free quality education, to free water and sanitation, to electricity, to developmental benefits, to so many things that otherwise under capitalism would be commodities. I think we have dealt with that sufficiently. Now, coming to the historical account of what happened in Russia is that in the 19th century, or in the 1800s, the country called Russia was an empire, was a huge territory with approximately 120 to 130 million people and more than 190 ethnic groups, 190 different languages. And it was ruled by an aristocracy, a tyranny of royal people who were oppressing over 120 to 130 million people. The peasants, the workers, were living in absolute poverty under Tsarist Russia. So that aristocracy in Russia was called the Tsar. It was the most intolerant group of people that thought that they were ordained by God to rule over the people of Russia. And on many occasions, different groupings, different political mobilizations tried to overthrow the Tsar, but they never succeeded. In many instances, they were faced with massacres. And actually, the leader of the Tsar in the late 1800s was a person called Nicholas II. And he said in 1904 that I shall never agree to a representative form of government because I consider it harmful to the people whom God has entrusted to my rule. So for a very long time you had an aristocracy, an elite of people that said that they are ordained by God, they will rule until Jesus comes back in Russia, who were ruling over Russia, over hundreds of millions of people, without democracy, intolerant to workers' demands, intolerant to peasants, intolerant to ordinary people. And one of the resistance movements, the greatest resistance movement, was the formation of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party in 1898. Which was a consolidation of all the fighting forces, which said that we are going to overthrow this Tsar. But earlier on, that Social Democratic Party in Russia began to be divided between what came to be known as the Mensheviks and the Bolsheviks. The Bolsheviks were under the leadership of Vladimir Lenin. So it was two factions that existed, institutionalized under one political party. They used to go to conferences, debate on issues. Some faction would win depending on the superiority of their argument at that time, depending on what kind of logic they would present. And then in 1905, I'm rushing to give you a clearer historical account. Workers in Russia marched against the Tsar. On the 9th of January, they marched and then they were killed, a lot of them. A massacre happened on the instruction of Nicholas II, who said that we cannot tolerate dissidents. But even after the massacre happened, the protest action of workers continued until he came to the conclusion that let us maybe constitute a representative body called the Duma. The Duma in Russia was the National Assembly of that particular time. To say, let us constitute an assembly which is going to represent the people. But even after he had done that, he continued to exist and operate in the same way that he did before the Duma was constituted. And in the following years, the struggle still continued. So those of you who are students of history, you will know that in 1914, the World War I began. And Russia was part of the World War I. So because there was no democratically elected government in Russia, the leader of the Tsar said that he is going to lead the military to fight in the World War. From 1915, he was the commander-in-chief of the army there, saying that he is going to fight the World War so that Russia can gain its rightful place in world politics. And as a result of that, when he was leading the war in the First World War, he then said, no, his wife must continue to lead the people of Russia. 120, 130 million people. He says, no, my wife will take care with advisors. I'm going to fight the war. As a result, because there was no proper coordination of affairs in Russia, there began to be shortage of food, shortage of basic needs and basic necessities for the people. And then in January 1917, in the middle of the war, the people said that let us commemorate the 1905 Bloody Sunday, the January 9, 1905 Bloody Sunday where the workers were killed. Let us march to commemorate that. And then in January 1917, that is when the revolution began. I'm going to take you briefly of what happened afterward. The struggle continued. People demanding bread, saying that we want bread, we do not want to be in war. And then because of the intensification of the struggle in February, the Duma was dissolved by the people. It never had the legitimacy. That National Assembly of the Russians was dissolved by the people in what later on came to be known as a bourgeois democratic revolution. Why was it called bourgeois? Because it did not have socialist and clear ideological guidance and underpinnings to it. It was just a reform that happened, a revolution, a bloodless revolution that changed the dominance of the Tsar and replaced it with a representative body which was referred as the Provisional Government of Russia. Our country is at war. The people do not have food. But there's a provisional government that doesn't have legitimacy. What is to be done? And then he said to the people of Russia that let us not recognize this provisional government. Let us elect Soviets in all the towns and cities of Russia. And the Soviets are going to be parallel power bases against this provisional government which was not elected. Then the Soviets became the parallel government to the provisional government which was under the leadership of Alexander Kerensky. So throughout the rule of the provisional government, they knew that real power stayed and was in the hands of the Soviets. So every decision that they had to take, they had to consult with the Soviets. And the Soviets were elected structures in all the cities and towns of Russia. And then Lenin came to provide clear and decisive ideological and political leadership to the Russian Revolution. And you must take note of this, that the slogan which Lenin developed that time, he said, it's peace, bread and land. He said, we're fighting for bread, peace and land. He said, we're fighting for land, bread and peace, and all power to the Soviets. So there are those who say, even in academic circles these days, that the land question doesn't find any expression within the Marxist-Leninist paradigm. The slogan, the fighting motto, the fighting inspiration of the great socialist revolution was peace, bread and land, and all power to the Soviets. And through continued agitation, the Bolsheviks was able to take charge of the Soviets and was able to overthrow the provisional government. And on the 25th and 26th of October, I must explain this, you must pay attention to this. On the 25th and 26th of October, the Bolsheviks led the people to Petrograd, to the headquarters of the provisional government, to take political power. That was the victory of the socialist revolution. Now, the 25th and 26th October was, according to the Russian calendar, was as per the Russian calendar. So in terms of the Gregorian calendar which we use now, the dates would have been the 7th and 8th of November, because the Gregorian calendar was 13 days ahead of the Russian calendar. I'm mentioning this because all over the world this year, between the 7th and the 12th of November, so many socialists all over the world will be commemorating the 100th anniversary of the great October Socialist Revolution. That will be exactly 100 years since it happened. Part of us, as the leadership of the EFF, will be participating in the Historical Materialism Conference that is organized in the School of Oriental and African Studies in the University of London. And we'll be gathering with socialists from all over the world to make a reflection of what happened to the great socialist October Revolution. What were the causes of the collapse of the Soviet Union? So that we can come with proper solutions. Now, 18 days, 18 hours, I mean to say, 18 hours after the socialists, after the Bolsheviks took power in Russia in 1917, Lenin said that there is no one, there is no private individual who is in ownership of the land any longer. The land is transferred to the people. 18 hours. He didn't even wait for one day to finish because he wanted to keep true to his promise. And he immediately withdrew Russia from the world war and said that my demand for peace is going to be realized now. And he immediately introduced the minimum wage for all the workers. And then he said that there must never be a single public official, whether a member of parliament or whether a minister, who must earn more than a skilled worker. So the capitalist propaganda will tell you that after the victory of the socialist revolution in Russia, there were so many problems. It's not true. Russia got to achieve a lot under a socialist government. You must remember that when Russia transited to socialism, it was relatively a backward country. Out of the 120 to 130 million Russians, the industrial workers were less than 4 million. That is less than 10% of the population. It was not a highly industrialized nation. Literacy rates were at 20%. But when the socialists took over, within few years they were able to obliterate illiteracy. They were able to educate all the Russians. They were able to introduce quality, superior education to most of their people. They gave access to free health care. Russia is still today a beneficiary of superior health care. That is why when people claim to be poisoned here in South Africa, their first stop is Russia. Because of the benefits of a socialist transition. In the first 5 years of socialist control of Russia, the economy grew by an average of 20% per year, meaning that there was rapid industrial expansion. What does that tell you? The capitalist and capitalist propaganda says that the economy can only expand under capitalism. The economy can only grow if there is competition amongst industrialists. But here is a scientific example of Russia that expanded its economy under socialism. That is why the EFF founding manifesto says, as part of its cardinal pillars, that we're going to fight for massive industrial protected expansion. It's part of our founding pillars. Because we know that under a planned economy, you can achieve high levels of industrial expansion. But also Russia immediately abolished the inequalities that existed between men and women. One of the central tasks of the Russian Revolution was to emancipate women. Because under the Tsar, under the aristocracy of the Tsar, women were not allowed rights. But when the Russian Revolution happened, women were given access to rights. And you must remember that immediately after the victory of the Russian Revolution, there were attempts to sponsor counter-revolution. America, Britain, Japan, Germany, Canada, all the countries, they sent armies to try to stop the socialist revolution in Russia by sponsoring something was called the White Army. And Lenin instituted what was called the Red Army to defeat all of them combined. They came from all corners, but all of them were combined. More than 16 countries entered Russia to defeat, to fight against the socialist revolution. But they were all defeated. And when they were defeated, they went back home and started the propaganda against socialist reconstruction of society. And from there on, Russia was a central role player in the anti-colonial movement, in the progressive movements all over the world. The Chinese Revolution happened with the inspiration of the Russian Revolution. Mao Zedong took inspiration from Lenin. That is why the Communist Party of China characterized itself as Marxist-Leninist. It's only later on in life that the Communist Party of China added Mao Zedong and Deng Xiaoping as part of their ideological guides. And I saw in a recent past congress of the Communist Party of China that they are saying that Xi Jinping is part of the ideological thoughts that must be looked into as well. But the original inspiration of the Chinese Revolution was Marxist-Leninist. Cuba was inspired by the Russian Revolution and supported against embargoes by the US and all imperialist forces. The Russian Revolution anchored the Cuban Revolution. The independence of many countries in the African continent was anchored by the Russian. They did not just say we are going to issue a statement as a message of support. They sent in soldiers to come and fight physically against imperialist forces here in the African continent. When we speak, for instance, about Quito Carnival, the Quito Carnival was a battle that was anchored, yes, by the military, by the soldiers from Cuba, but also from the Soviet Union. And if one day you give yourself time to study about the significance of the Battle of Quito Carnival, you will realize that the reason why apartheid South Africa went to negotiate on the table, opted for negotiation, is because they realized that they can lose a physical war, which had started in Quito Carnival in Angola. And it was coming this side, could have obliterated the apartheid army. So the Russians played a central role in the anti-colonial movements, not only in Africa, in many parts of the world. I'll tell you something which those who give memorial services of the dying organization, the ANC, do not mention. You know, in the ANC, memorial services are used to fight factional battles. They are not teaching each other anything. They use dead people to fight against each other. This one says, no, Oliver Tambo said you can't be a leader. This other one says that, no, Ahmed Kathrada says you can't be a leader. And then they use dead people to fight amongst themselves. In the EFF, we use public lectures to educate ourselves, to sharpen ourselves ideologically. Now, the fourth president of the ANC, J.T. Gumede, went to celebrate the 10th anniversary of the Socialist Revolution in Russia. So that is 90 years ago. J.T. Gumede said he was invited by the League Against Imperialism to go and celebrate the 10th anniversary of the Great Socialist Revolution in Russia. And when he came back from there, he said that, I've been to Russia, I've seen equality of the people, people have got land access, there is no racism, and I've actually seen the new Jerusalem. And I've brought back the keys that are going to unlock the door to freedom. And guess what happened immediately said that. True to its reactionary foundation, the ANC called an illegal conference, a quick congress, to remove JT Gumede, and said that you cannot be our leader because this thing of equality would not want it here in the ANC. Actually, the founder of the ANC, Sticker Isaac Asebe, said, I cannot imagine being equal to the person who milked my cattle. Because those of you who will later on study the history of the so-called glorious liberation movement will appreciate that they were not fighting for all the black people in South Africa. They were fighting for freedoms of civilized black males. And they recognized the authority of the queen. They recognized that they are subjects of the queen. That is why the first 40 conferences of the ANC were opened officially. Actually, the first 44, if not the first 45 conferences, were opened by the apartheid government, by the ministers of native affairs. So they never had problem. They were just sending petitions to say, at least accommodate us. Perhaps a proper reading of what has happened thus far is that they have achieved what they've been fighting for. Because they wanted a small portion of society to enter to eat at the expense of the majority. That is what they've achieved thus far. They are unable to liberate majority of the black majority and Africans in particular. And that can be traced to the umbilical cord of the ANC. It has not always been revolutionary. It has always fought for exclusive groups. We always knew about this. And we raised it even when we associated with the Congress movement. It's not the first time that we raise these issues. Now, the second component I'm going to briefly speak about, comrades, is the biggest contribution, to appreciate the contribution of Vladimir Lenin in the Socialist Revolution, is to just familiarize yourselves with the writings, the perspectives that over time he developed. I already spoke about what is to be done. So all of you, whenever you get time during the festive season, you must write a perspective of what is to be done, the burning questions of our movement, published in 1901. You must read the April thesis. I spoke about the April thesis, that it was the program of action that catapulted the revolution towards its logical conclusion. But you must read the state and revolution. Now, the most important component of Lenin's political life was his characterization of the state. One, he says that the state is a product of the irreconcilability of class antagonisms. What does that mean? He says that the institution that we call the state is a product of the fact that contending classes, the working class and the capitalist, cannot have reconcilable interest. So the state emerges as supposedly a moderator of the competing interest of the working class against the capitalists. And then he makes an observation that despite the fact that it emerges out of that irreconcilability of class antagonisms, the state still remains as an instrument of class rule. So the dominant class always becomes the ruling class in any society. And its ideas, the ideas of that society, are always the ideas of the ruling class. Far much earlier, when he was conceptualizing the state, Marx says that a government in a class capitalist society is nothing but an executive that manages the common affairs of the bourgeoisie. They are just sent around by the bourgeoisie that People are striking against us in Marukana, go and kill them, and then they go and do exactly that. That is what happens with the character of the state. But it doesn't end there. He says that the working class, when it takes that state through political power, it must institute dictatorship of the proletariat, which is dictatorship of the majority, and suppress the capitalist system, which when time progresses will wither away, and then will transit to a socialist revolution, to a communist society. Without a proper understanding of the state, we will always make a lot of tactical and strategic mistakes in our political struggles. So all of us have an obligation to understand what is the character of the state anywhere where we live. One of the most important characterizations of colonization is in a perspective by Lenin called imperialism, the highest stage of capitalism. And all of us as students, we must familiarize ourselves with that perspective. Now, I spoke about J.T.'s Gumede's visit to the Soviet Union and how he was internally suppressed. But the rising strength of the Soviet Union, of the great socialist October Revolution, of a socialist Russia, determined liberation politics and apartheid politics in South Africa. To the extent that in 1950, apartheid government passed something called the Suppression of Communism Act. So the Suppression of Communism Act was a law that made it illegal to do what we are doing today. Just to mention Lenin, under apartheid was against the law. To talk about the revolution, under apartheid was against the law. To carry a book about state and revolution or about Marxism under apartheid was against the law. To say that you want to change society for the better under apartheid was against the law. And all the perceptions that they drew, so many people were killed, so many people were imprisoned, so many people were tortured because the apartheid government said that we are suppressing communism. And the socialist Russia didn't fold its arms, but said, let us help you to fight against this apartheid. They did everything in their power. They trained some of the people and they mistrained some of the people. There were some people who were trained wrongly in Russia. And one of those is Jacob Zuma, because he went to Russia, I think, for 2 weeks. And then he came without a proper understanding of what is to be done, but also a proper characterization of the national question in South Africa was inspired by the outcomes of the great socialist revolution. And Lenin said on the national question that all the countries that are under colonial oppression do not have to go through the route of capitalist development. They must take political power and drive a program directly towards socialism. Develop the productive forces themselves. They must not wait for capitalist maturation before a revolution could happen under a socialist guideline. That is the approach to the national question. That is what was supposed to be a national democratic revolution. But it had been misused on many occasions and it is not understood properly. To illustrate to you that the Soviet Union politics influenced a lot what happened in South Africa is, on the 2nd of November 1990, when F.W. de Klerk released political prisoners, when F.W. de Klerk unbanned political parties, when F.W. de Klerk released Nelson Mandela, who had spent 18 years in prison and the remaining years in the house. He then he said that the events in the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, to which I have referred already, weakened the capability of organizations which were previously supported strongly from these quarters. The activities of the organizations from which the prohibitions are now being lifted no longer entail the same degree of threat to internal security which initially necessitated the imposition of the prohibitions. So the unbanning of the ANC, of the PAC, of all the liberation movements, the release of political prisoners in South Africa, was on the backdrop that the Soviet Union had collapsed in the manner in which it was constituted. We will talk about some of the factors that led to the collapse of the Soviet Union, because in 1991, the Socialist Soviet Union collapsed. It was taken over by reactionary forces because the leadership of the revolution had been absorbed into something wrong. The leadership of the party had become corrupt. They had mixed their power with the power of the people. They had not planned properly on how to sustain the revolution. And this is despite the fact that the socialist benefits had made Russia to be power. And to be a superpower means that we have got the military capacity to fight against the whole world. Russia was a superpower. It had influenced and protected so many countries in the world. But narrow subjective reasons collapsed the revolution. And this is a great lesson to us today, that if we do not become consistent politically and ideologically, the revolution will not sustain itself. That is why we have to reproduce ourselves every day and everywhere. We must have the patience of ideological reproduction. Because you can't call yourself a revolutionary if you cannot reproduce yourself. If you can't ideologically reproduce yourself, you are not a revolutionary. If you do not have the power to persuade, you are not a revolutionary. You are just a fellow traveler. If you can't convince anyone to believe or to see the same things in the way you do, we have an obligation to always reproduce ourselves. Now, comrades, I think that one of the most important things that, before I speak now about the nature of capitalism in South Africa, there are four aspects that broadly define the changing nature of capitalism in the world now. And that means that as revolutionaries, we have an obligation to come with far much more superior means of fighting against capitalism. The first new feature of global capitalism is that it is becoming institutionalized. The fact of the matter is that institutions instead of individuals are beginning to take ownership of a bigger portion of capital, and that is a fact. Here in South Africa, Old Mutual, Sanlam, the PIC, Alan Gray, Coronation, and all the asset management companies are in control of assets worth close to 9 trillion rands. To the extent that they hide the real capitalist in the buffer of institutional ownership. So the capitalists are beginning to be institutions. That is one thing which you as students must study closely and begin to understand. And advise us, what do we do under institutional capitalism? The second feature is the emergence of artificial and the dominance of artificial intelligence. So they call it the fourth industrial revolution. Because a lot of jobs are being lost. In the so-called ITZ here in South Africa, a lot of robots are replacing workers. When the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, the biggest promoters of open markets were America, the British, and all these Western countries. But now, because they are beginning to be victims of neoliberalism, with the rising capacity of China, they are beginning to be protectionist. Donald Trump won elections in the US because of protectionist policies. Because he promised workers that I'm going to bring back all the industries that had migrated. So the promoters of neoliberalism are now being protectionist. The fourth component is what we speak about in Parliament every day, that capital is developing a sophisticated way of hiding the wealth that they accumulate in different nation states. They go to places called tax havens. So there's a difference between a heaven and a haven. So they go to places called tax havens through transfer pricing, profit shifting, and all those things, illicit financial flows, to go and hide a lot of wealth in tax havens. Say that even when we are going to expropriate the wealth, they already have taken a lot of it to tax havens. We are not just theorizing in the EFF, we are finding that even at a sophisticated level. That is why we have taken time, after raising this issue for 2 years now, to start with legislating, to draft legislation ourselves on how we fight against tax avoidance, against illicit financial flows. So we are going to put a private member's bill in Parliament that will come with a complex way of fighting against illicit financial flows. I can tell you for free today that the ANC doesn't possess that capacity. They have no such capacity to could fight against the sophisticated manner of global capitalism. We are the only political movement that can defeat global capitalism and retain the wealth of our people to their hands. But that doesn't fundamentally shift what is the character of capitalism in South Africa, because in South Africa we have got capitalism that is largely defined by our historical past. So the few features that we'll talk about is perhaps the six major features that define capitalism in South Africa. One is that capitalism in South Africa is white. Anyone who denies that the owners of the means of production remain white in South Africa is daydreaming. It's not thinking properly. Do you know in South Africa, I'll give you a simple example. In the major stores, in ShopRite, in Pick n Pay, in Spy, in Boxer, and all those stores, we have got more than 10,500 different products. There is not even a single product that is supplied by a black person at a national level. Not one black person. There is no black person who owns meaningfully an industry that can take care of the whole nation. It's white minority that is in control of capital in South Africa. And it's few white individuals who are in control of that capital in South Africa. is the descendants of the Oppenheimer Empire. It's the Rupert's. It's Gross Becker. It's Christoph Wies, who owns Shoprite, Pep, Haifa Corporation, almost everything. Johan Rupert controls everything, Colgate, everything. Sugar that you consume every day, cigarettes that you smoke every day, they control that. Rainbow Chicken. They own and control all of these things. Meaning that there is not a single individual in South Africa who in a day doesn't interact with either a Gross Becker or Christoph Wies or Rupert product. Wealth is concentrated in few hands in South Africa. And to deconcentrate wealth needs a decisive socialist approach and reconstruction of society. There is no form of black economic empowerment that is going to change the status quo. They tried many times and invited Patrice Motsepe, Cyril Ramaphosa, Thoko Sekgala into the dinner table. But capital remains white in South Africa. That is why even when you are trying to count those that were invited by white capital into the dinner table, you won't finish two hands. You'll count with this one when you jump aside, the names are finished. But even if you were to have black capitalists, it doesn't mean anything. Because we are not just fighting for narrow deracialization. We are fighting against capitalism itself. And if you do not understand that we are fighting against private ownership of the means of production, then you won't understand the nature of our struggle. But also capitalism in South Africa is parasitic. Parasitic is that you have got those that do not own anything meaningful. The only thing they own is a phone to phone Jacob Zuma to say one tender for this and that and that. Those are parasitic capitalists, the Guptas, the white tenderpreneurs who take major infrastructure programs. Because the tenderpreneurs here in South Africa is the Guptas, it's white capital, it's middle management of municipalities and provincial governments, and petty corrupt people in small municipalities like in Nguma and in Ogum Gijima there in the Eastern Cape, who sell a rubbish bag bin for R1,000 to the municipality. Those are parasitic capitalists which you must fight against. And one thing that you must never make a mistake as the EFF on is to think that we will just fight one manifestation of capitalism at the expense of fighting the other. We are fighting against capitalism as a whole. When we are fighting the Guptas, it doesn't mean we are not fighting against the corruption represented by Johan Rupert, Gross Becker, Christoph Wies, the Raymond Ackerman family and all of them. We are fighting all of them combined. Another factor of capitalism in South Africa is that it is neoliberal. Neoliberal means that you have opened up your economy too much, such that foreign investments and foreign corporations dominate a bigger portion of your life. South Africa currently imports more than 80% of the furniture, something that could create jobs here in South Africa. That is the neoliberal character of capitalism in South Africa. And when we fight against neoliberalism, it means we must be willing to stand against global capitalist multinational corporations. And it's not only the material benefits and material products which they bring to South Africa. They even bring what are professional services. The McKinsey's of this world, the SAP of this world, the KPMG's, the PwC, all of those who are stealing our monies. Yes. Billions of rands is stolen from South Africa through the neoliberal policy. And that is why in the EFF founding manifesto, as part of the seven cardinal pillars, we said, let us build state capacity in order to abolish tenders. It's because we want to build capacity to provide all the services that are provided by McKinsey, by SAP, by KPMG, by PwC, by Ernst & Young, by all these huge corporations. They are capable black and Africans who can do things for themselves here in South Africa. And it's only the state that can create a platform for such to happen. But currently South Africa is leaderless. We do not have decisive leadership that will take our country forward. But what is to be done, comrades? What is to be done? What do we have to do? What is the greatest honor we can give to the October Great Socialist Revolution? What is the greatest honor we can give to Vladimir Lenin? We said in 2013 that Lenin is our inspiration. Lenin was uncompromising. Lenin was very decisive. Lenin said that if you give me only one generation of the youth, I can change the whole world. One generation of youth, I can change the whole world. Why are we not taking inspiration from Lenin to change the world? We need to intensify the struggle, the war for economic freedom. And in the war for economic freedom, there will be battle sites. Some of the battles will lose, some of the battles we are going to win. Some of the battles we will take tactical decisions that will not appear immediately revolutionary. That is the nature of the war for economic freedom. We are going to be engaged in so many battles. Here, the Western Cape, this is a battle site as well in the war for economic freedom. The victory of the SRC is a step forward towards the war for economic freedom. So don't underestimate yourself. It is not just about hot water. It's not only about that. It's about fitting to the war for economic freedom. But rest assured, all the commitments which the SRC makes here must be and will be realized. That is why in majority of the campuses where the EFF Students Command wins, it's Hasta la Victoria Siempre, meaning that that victory lasts forever. Since the EFF Student Command won SRC elections 3 years ago in VUT, every year the EFF Student Command wins 100% of the vote there. And every year the vote increases. It's the same thing in the University of Venda. It's the same thing in the University of Limpopo in Teflop campus. It is going to be the same thing in Venda University as well. When an SRC of the Student Command wins, you must know that it is not just a victory here in campus. It's part of the generational war to attain economic freedom in our lifetime. It's a generational war to realize the socialist reconstruction of society. That is why you are not ashamed to come here and speak about the socialist revolution in the middle of elections. So we want to remind and encourage all the students here in UWC to go and vote in your numbers, to vote for the EFF Students Command. We are not going to micromanage the SRC as the EFF leadership. But whenever there is difficulties, they will call on us and we will be there. Because we are always on the ground, we listen to the people at all times. And we want to encourage all the students here in WC to join in the struggle for free, quality and dignified education. The war for economic freedom must be realized under the leadership and guidance of the student command. Yes, yes. You must never retreat. These other ones are going to be called to the Tule House to be told that you must relax a bit. Because we've got a job for you. So you must never look up to organizations whose mother bodies are dying organizations. We must come up to the EFF Student Command and elect these capable leaders who are going to be leaders of the future. The EFF must exist everywhere, must inspire confidence, must fight until we realize socialism in our lifetime. Amanda!